Hey, you guys, book review time once again. Got a big chonker for you today. I almost didn't think I was going to finish this in time because I was one of those, I read pretty fast, if you guys don't know. And I've read books like way longer than this in a shorter amount of time. But I had gotten to a point where I was like, shit, man, it's like, I really, really need to record this like today. And I was afraid that I wasn't going to be able to finish. So like the last couple of days, I had to like just sit down and do two marathon sessions on the shit because just like the book is so long. And it's not only that it's long. I mean, it's not super long. It's 600 something pages, 620 pages, something like that, which isn't terribly long, but it's still kind of long. It's just that it's a very dense book with a lot of detail and things like that. So some parts of it, I'm not gonna lie, were a little bit of a slog. So I'll get into that in a little bit. The book I'm talking about is The Fifth Heart by Dan Simmons. Now, this is actually not the first Dan Simmons book that I've read. I read Summer of Night, I think, and the sequel to that, which was called The Winter Haunting, which was very good. I read The Terror, which was amazing. They made that into a miniseries, which was also amazing. And I read Drood, which is probably one of my very favorite novels of all time. And I bought a copy of it not too long ago because I wanted to reread it and do a review of this like probably before the end of the year. Now, what happened with this book? This came out in 2015, and I had actually never heard of it. I was in downtown Sanford a few months back, probably back, I think this must have been before January then, because I think this was on my TBR show. And I was in a used bookstore in downtown Sanford, and I saw it. And I was like, ooh, Dan Simmons, the same guy that wrote Drood. And when I read the synopsis of this, it sounded very much like along the same lines as Drood. So I was like, man, this sounds really good. Like, I'm getting it. And I didn't read it for a while because, like I said, it's kind of long. I was afraid I wasn't going to finish it for this week's show because I was going to have to like pick something shorter. But I did actually finish it yesterday and I have like some feelings about it. Okay. So you know how Drood is about two real historical figures, Charles Dickens and Wilkie Collins, and they are essentially chasing a fictional character from Charles Dickens' real last work, which he didn't finish. So this is kind of along the same lines. This is not a horror novel. This is more like a historical mystery. And also, it's kind of like a Sherlock Holmes mystery. Well, not even kind of like, it is a Sherlock Holmes story, but also kind of a partial metafiction. It's real weird. I'll get into it. So the main character of this book really is Henry James, the real American writer, wrote Portrait of a Lady, The Americans, The Bostonians, Turn of the Screw, that guy. So at the beginning of the book, he's in a bit of a slump. Well, I guess it's more than that. He's about to turn 50. His books haven't been selling as well. His beloved sister has just died. And so he decides he's going to end it all. So he has cadged a little bit of his sister's ashes and put them in, because I guess they went to like her, you know, female friend or companion or whatever, and he was kind of pissed off about it. So he stole some of her ashes, put them in like a really nice little box, and he's going to put them in his pocket, go to Paris, and commit suicide by jumping in the Seine. Now, while he's in the process of doing this, he runs into another dude who's lurking around in the shadows. And even though this person is in disguise, which I'll get into in a bit, he immediately recognizes him as Sherlock Holmes. Yes, in this universe, Sherlock Holmes is a real person, or is he? Because we find out that okay, this is kind of complicated. It's going to sound like I'm like really high, like when I'm talking about how this book goes, but just kind of bear with me. So this guy is really Sherlock Holmes. Henry James had met him at a party 4 years prior. So like I said, we're operating under the assumption that he's a real person. However, he's in disguise as another presumably real person, a Norwegian explorer who's kind of well-known across the world named, I think his name is Jan Sigurdsson. I'm not actually sure if that's a real person because there's a lot of real people turn up in this book. So he's pretending to be him, but Henry James recognizes him as Sherlock Holmes, and then Sherlock Holmes is also about to commit suicide by jumping into the Seine because he said, I have just come to the realization that I am a fictional character, okay? So as I said, this is where the metafiction aspect of this book comes in, because Sherlock Holmes, you're never entirely sure if he's a real guy, if he's fictional. And then it kind of gives Henry James like an existential crisis, because he's like, well, if Sherlock Holmes is a literary construct and I met him before and I'm like hanging out with him and going on this like mystery adventure that they go on in this giant book, maybe I am also a fictional creation. Okay, I am gonna say there's other kind of shit that happens in this book, and there is actually like a mystery involved and stuff, but I'll get into that in a minute. But this metafiction aspect, that I think was one of the things that fascinated me about this topic. But I kind of like historical mysteries. I liked, like I said, I really liked Drood, where he did kind of the same thing, where he had real historical characters, you know, getting involved in this mystery with some people that were real and some that weren't. This one is kind of like that, but it seems more, I'm not really sure what the word I want to use. It's almost like contrived, because there's a couple points where the narrator, who you're presuming is Dan Simmons, the guy that wrote the book, comes in and explains like, oh, well, now we're going to switch focus. You know, before we were doing everything from Henry James's point of view, but from this point forward, I'm going to switch around to the different, which seemed a little weird and a little unnecessary. And the fact that he did that so early in the book and then didn't really do it again, the only time that he kind of steps in, he only steps in as the author, presumably, like maybe two or three times, something like that. So it seemed kind of like weird. And also the whole through line of Sherlock Holmes not being a real person, and then maybe everybody being a literary construct in this whole like existential crisis that he's having, I feel like that should have been a larger part of the narrative, because it's only brought up a few times, like in a few conversations that they have. So I feel like if he wanted that to be sort of like the main theme of the book, maybe it should have been, I don't know, I think I would have liked to see it like integrated into the story more. So the story, after Henry James meets Sherlock Holmes, Sherlock Holmes is able to, they're kind of able to convince each other not to kill themselves. Sherlock Holmes says, I have this mystery and I want you to help me. I don't really know why he wanted Henry James particularly to help him, you know, because he's like telling Henry James that it's like, oh, Dr. Watson, who we're not sure is a real person or not either, because we'd never meet him. It's like, he's the guy that just writes down my adventures, because Arthur Conan Doyle is like his manager or his agent or something. And it's like, so they have to change a lot of details of the real shit that we do into these popular novels. So a lot of the stuff that you read in The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, presumably written by Arthur Conan Doyle, is not really what happened, because we had to change a lot of details because we don't want anyone's real identity coming out or whatever. He also says, too, that Moriarty isn't real, but then later on in the story, someone that he identifies as Moriarty does turn up as an antagonist, but that's kind of resolved in a real weird way too. So Sherlock Holmes says, I've got this mystery. What ended up happening was this guy named Edward Ned Hooper, who was a real historical figure. He gave me a dollar retainer to find out what happened to his sister, Clover Adams, also a real person. She was actually a photographer, and she was married to the very famous historian Henry Adams, who is also a character in this book. Clover Adams, she committed suicide 7 years previously by drinking, I think it was potassium chloride, the stuff she used for her photographic chemicals. And that actually did really happen. That is how she died. She committed suicide by drinking her photographic chemicals. That wasn't what the media reported, but that's what they said later on. That's how she really died. So that's a real event. But in the universe of this book, he's saying, yes, that's what everybody said, that she drank it and she committed suicide. Yes, she was a very depressed person, which she was in real life. But he's like, the brother, Ned Hooper, who has since died, he was convinced that Clover was murdered. And so he wanted Sherlock Holmes to find out who killed her. One of the things that is making him think that is that every December 6th, the anniversary of Clover's death, the members of the Five of Hearts, which was like kind of a group, like a loose social circle that included Clover, her husband Henry, and like some other real historical figures that lived around there, kind of high society Washington, D.C. people, This story takes place in the late 1800s, in case I didn't mention it. 1893, somewhere around there. So every year on December 6th, each surviving member of the Five of Hearts gets a little typed card that has four of the hearts colored in. There's little hearts on the top. And somebody has typed on it, "She was murdered." And they send it every single year. So Sherlock Holmes is not only trying to find out who the hell is sending these cards, but also if she was murdered or if she committed suicide or what the hell is going on. For whatever reason, he decides, because like I said, they're in France at the beginning. Henry James is American. He was American, but he lived in England most of his life, I believe. I don't know a huge amount. I feel like this is one of those books where if you know a lot about Henry James as a person, I've read some of his works. I've read Turn of the Screw. I read Portrait of a Lady, stuff like that. I don't know a lot about him as an individual, but I have read some of his stuff. So if you know about Henry James, if you know about the history of the United States right around 1893, particularly the history of D.C. and Chicago, you know, the 1893 World's Fair, you know, the Columbian Expedition, because that kind of figures in the third act of this book. And also, if you're real up on your Sherlock Holmes lore, then you will probably really dig this. If you're not, you might not enjoy it as much, because this book is just chock full of period detail and facts and just all of these little, you know, things, little nuggets of information about these real people and about these real events and this time period. And if you don't already have a penchant for that type of thing, then probably you will get really bored or you will get really annoyed really quick, because there is a story, like I said, there is a mystery, like the proposed murder of Clover Adams is kind of a through line that runs through the book, like the mystery that they're trying to solve. But there's a lot of little byways, little subplots, kind of some fan service, like for Sherlock Holmes fans. One of the characters in there is Irene Adler, who was a character in, I believe, the first Sherlock Holmes story, which was Scandal in Bohemia, I think it was called. Like, she turned up in there, and I think she turned up in some subsequent stories as well. So she's actually a character in this too. So if you know a lot about Sherlock Holmes stuff, then probably you'll really dig this, because there's a lot of, you know, I have a passing familiarity. I haven't read all the stuff. I've read a few of them. I knew enough to like recognize some of the names and recognize some of the tropes, but somebody that is really, really into it will probably get a lot more out of it. Also, like I said, you really have to be into the history of this time period, because, as I said, the story does go on and things happen and, you know, a mystery gets solved, but there's a lot of digressions about, you know, particularly toward, you know, the third act, where they're going to, like, the kind of climax takes place at the 1893 World's Fair, which is also the whole H.H. Holmes situation. I was kind of hoping that H.H. Holmes would turn up in this book too, but he doesn't, spoiler alert. Which I think that would have been pretty rad, but no. So there's a lot of detail about the World's Fair, like how the stuff was constructed, how big the Ferris wheel was, like what all the, you know, what all the stuff of the White City was made of and all this other kind of stuff, which is all like really cool. But I feel like some reviews of this that I saw on Goodreads, this seems to be the kind of book that that people were like, love it. Or some people were like, dude, you did some research. Okay, we get it. You know what I mean? It's kind of like, you don't have to put every single nugget of it in the fucking book. Just like, get on with the story. I'm kind of like fell in the middle of that. And a lot of people that said that, you know, liked a lot of other Dan Simmons stuff, because he's written a ton of stuff. He's written some historical fiction. Like I said, Drood is my favorite. He's also, and The Terror, also very good. He's written a lot of sci-fi. I haven't really read any of the sci-fi, but I've read some of his horror, and his horror is actually really good. But so he writes in a lot of different genres. So just be prepared for the fact that you really need to get immersed in this world, and there's just a lot of detail. Just keep in mind that there's going to be a lot of digressions about the history of certain things, like that kind of come up along the way, the backstories of all these people, who a lot of whom are real people, were real historical figures. So if that sounds like it's going to like bore the shit out of you, then probably you should not pick this book up. Because like I said, it's very long and it's a commitment. And as I said, I was compelled to finish it to the end, but I can see how some people would just be like, give up on it because they're just kind of like, man, are we ever going to get back to? And I felt like the mystery, while I wanted to see it solved, I felt like the mystery wasn't quite as compelling as it could have been, like to get us from point A to point B. But that said, you know, as I said, a lot of historical figures, you know, real people show up in this. Teddy Roosevelt turns up a couple times. Samuel Clemens, aka Mark Twain, he's in there a few times. You know, just John Hay. A lot of, you know, kind of, you know, I think they mentioned Boss Tweed. I can't remember who else like shows up in here. Like a lot of sort of high society figures, like I said, from DC, like in the late 19th century and, you know, kind of Chicago type of thing. So there's a lot of that in there. So if you're real into history, like it'll be super neat because you'll be just like, hey, it's that guy, like that guy's turning up or whatever. And like I said, he is using an actual event, Clover Adams actually drinking photographic chemicals and committing suicide and making that the fulcrum of the story, you know, because that really did happen to her. And actually all the shit, and it's, I didn't even know this until I looked at the Wikipedia page, but there's a scene in this where Henry Adams, her husband, had a memorial built to her, you know, a sculptor named Saint Gaudin. I can't remember. I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right, but he's like kind of a famous sculptor. And, he had the memorial statue built to her in Rock Creek Cemetery, and that is actually real. That is real, really there. And the way that it's described in the book is actually real. So like I said, I didn't love this book. I mean, Drood, I loved it, and I want to read it again. This is along the same lines, but I guess because I'm not as familiar with Sherlock Holmes stories as I am, you know, Wilkie Collins, for example, because I knew a lot more about Wilkie Collins and Charles Dickens and stuff. And so I was kind of like more invested in that story. This is along the same lines, because you kind of have, it has like a little bit of sly humor to it. And it's kind of almost kind of like a buddy mystery because Sherlock Holmes is, you know, Sherlock Holmes and he's the way he is. And he's kind of, as I said, having a sort of existential crisis over whether he's a real character or a fictional character, which I think is really intriguing, and I wish more had been done with that instead of it just kind of turning up as a plot point every now and then. Henry James in this is kind of like a good foil for him because he's just this kind of pudgy, prissy dude. He's not really a man of action. He's a kind of whiny. It's like he doesn't even know why he feels compelled to go along with Sherlock Holmes in this, and he's always like complaining about it, but it's always like kind of funny too in a way. I don't know if that's what he was really like as a person. I would imagine probably so, because Dan Simmons does do a huge amount of research for these, and he's like a big history junkie apparently. So I'm assuming that that's probably kind of what he was like. So those scenes of them where they're constantly like you know, babbling, and Henry James is just like, fuck this, I'm going home. It's like, why am I even here? It's like all this kind of stuff. So that kind of shit's funny. So the characterization is good. I just feel like the mystery of Clover Adams, who's, because it's not just we're trying to find out who killed this woman. When they're looking into the mystery, a bigger conspiracy comes about, but you're not really sure if the conspiracy is real or not. Like it has to do with the assassination of Grover Cleveland at the Chicago World's Fair, and Sherlock Holmes and Henry James trying to stop it, because apparently there's this big conspiracy of like anarchists and stuff that are gonna like blow up all these different cities and like kill all these cops and all this other kind of stuff. So you don't really know if that's a real thing or not, and you kind of don't know even toward the end because of the ways things go. I won't spoil it because I didn't really know much of what to expect when I was reading this, but it takes some interesting turns, but you really, really, really have to be into like minutia of American history, minutia of Sherlock Holmes stories, of Henry James stories, because there's a lot of stuff in here that refers to that. And if you don't know anything about it, then you might just be like, what the fuck? Like, why are we spending two pages like talking about, you know, this person who was a real person, but he's like a minor character in the story and doesn't have anything to do with pushing the story forward. So that sounds like it's going to like try your patience. Then I would not advise like reading this book because, like I said, it's very long and it's like a big commitment. I would probably, like, Drood was easily a five-star read for me. Like I said, that was one of my favorite books ever, and I'm really looking forward to reading it again to review for this show. This one, as I said, even though it's along the same lines, this one is not quite as creepy. It's not as horror-based because it's more of a... This is essentially a Sherlock Holmes story, but with other elements to it. So it's more like a mystery, like a historical mystery, with a lot of historical digressions, which are neat. You learn a lot of interesting shit that maybe you didn't know. But if you just want to get in there and get on with the mystery and get on with the story, then, as I said, your patience might be a little tried. Mine was a few times. I never felt compelled to be like, fuck it, I'm not finishing this. But sometimes I'd be reading it and I'd be starting to like kind of skim. It's like, well, are we getting back to the anarchists now? Or, you know, so it's like, can we please give, like, this is cool and everything, but yeah. So it was that kind of thing. But yeah, so all in all, I guess I would probably, if I had to give it a star rating, it'd probably be about 3. I found it compelling enough to finish, but I would have liked for the metafiction of Sherlock Holmes questioning his own fictional, whether he was fictional or not, I would have liked that to be a bigger part of the story and be more integrated into the story. And I would have liked the mystery to be more compelling. You know what I'm saying? It didn't really resonate with me as much as Drew did, I guess. But it's still a decent book. And as I said, if anything I've said, if you're fascinated by late 19th century America, Gilded Age type stuff, and you're really into Sherlock Holmes and stuff, then probably you would really dig this. Everybody else, I would not recommend it because you'll probably just be like, why? You know what I mean? It's going to be that kind of thing. But yeah, so overall, decent, but not as awesome as I was expecting, which is kind of a shame, but still like a decent read. All right, so that will do it for this Tomes of Terror. I will see you guys on the next one. Bye.